We Canadians have a very special relationship with our land. It inspires us, defines us, makes us humble in its presence. For 40 years, the Nature Conservancy of Canada has been dedicated to protecting the natural heritage of all Canadians. In that time, it has saved more than 1.7 million acres of important habitat for wildlife and for the benefit of future generations. And it all began with a vision. It was in Toronto, around 1960, that a group of friends, members of the Federation of Ontario Naturalists, realized that unless someone acted to protect natural spaces, the accelerating rhythms of a booming economy would soon consume much of the most ecologically significant land in southern Ontario. A case in point was Rattray Marsh, a biologically rich wetland just west of Toronto. The threat that the marsh might be drained, filled, and converted into real estate acted as a catalyst, sparking a campaign to purchase the site. In the end, the campaign failed to save all of Rattray Marsh. But an audacious concept had been born, namely that a determined partnership of caring citizens could initiate effective conservation through private action. In November 1962, the Government of Canada issued letters patent for the establishment of a private, science-driven, not-for-profit corporation to be called the Nature Conservancy of Canada. Its purpose? To secure ecologically important lands and protect them forever. One of the founders was Dr. J. Bruce Falls, then a professor of zoology at the University of Toronto.
I think at that particular time it was the culmination of feelings that had been developing for quite a while. The Federation of Ontario Naturalists had always thought that sanctuaries were one of the main things that they should pursue. And at this time, scientists were saying we need to protect areas in order to carry out research so that we can understand the environment. And what we were seeing was that many of the areas that we were interested in, many of the types of communities we thought should be protected, were disappearing or being degraded. And so we thought that we better get busy and do something about it.
Initially, the organization depended on volunteers to do its work, but it soon became necessary to add professional staff. In 1966, Charles Soriol, a longtime supporter of conservation projects, was appointed as administrative director. 3 years later, Aird Lewis, who had drafted the terms of reference for the organization and had been serving as chairman of the board, became the first full-time executive director. They made a powerful team.
Good, but Charles brought a lot of energy to it, was visiting donors. And I can remember the first time we met the Ivies, the Ivy Foundation. Charles and I went down there, and we went through this meeting, and Charles jumped in and explained very, very well the concept of matching grants that were available from government for things. And I was following him, we walked out, and Charles was elated, you see, out of this meeting. And I said, well, Charles, why are you so excited? He said, do you realize what just happened there? I think the Ivy Foundation is going to match the funds that we could organize from the government that they give to the Conservation Authority. And I said, well, I hope that's true. And he said, don't worry, I'm sure that's going to be the case, and I think we're going to have a long-term relationship. They're a wonderful group, and I said, they certainly are, but we'll keep our fingers crossed. Let's not get carried away. But as it turned out, that was the case, but he played a key role there.
Although the work focused at first on southern Ontario, it was intended from the outset that the organization should become national in scope. As early as 1968, the board of directors included distinguished volunteers such as conservation writer Roderick Haig Brown of British Columbia. Today, there are 7 regional offices across Canada, supported by a large core of dedicated volunteers and thousands of individual members and donors, among them many landowners who have made gifts of their own land. Through the 1980s, a shift in the broad public understanding of environmental issues helped build support for a radical new conservation concept. Moving beyond its initial focus on smaller, individual properties, NCC embraced the idea of doing its work on a landscape scale. An early example was Un fleuve, un parc, one river, one park, a visionary project to protect the islands in the St. Lawrence River between Montreal and Quebec City. Not only did the plan encompass a huge expanse of very significant wetlands, including one of North America's largest heron colonies, it also served as a model for cooperation with federal and provincial government agencies, charitable foundations, corporations, and individual private landowners. Working at a landscape level has put the Nature Conservancy of Canada at the forefront of environmental conservation planning. Projects to protect migratory wildlife corridors have taken on a growing importance. Successes include Shell Canada's generous gift of Mount Broadwood in the East Kootenay region of British Columbia, and BP Amoco's donation of mineral rights to the vast whaleback region of southwestern Alberta. On the prairie, NCC has worked with ranchers to conserve working ranches through ownership and conservation easements. Examples include the 13,000-acre Old Man on His Back Reserve in Saskatchewan and the Elkhorn Stock Ranch in Alberta. In southern Manitoba, NCC is contributing to the conservation of a growing expanse of tall grass prairie, one of the rarest landscapes in the country. In Ontario, landscape conservation has led to the preservation of many globally rare alvar ecosystems, exposed limestone flats where rare plant and animal species flourish. Examples of alvars saved include properties on Peely Island in western Lake Erie, the Cameron Ranch in central Ontario's Cardin Plain, and an 18,000-acre portion of Manitoulin Island in Lake Huron. In Atlantic Canada, the Johnson's Mills Nature Preserve at the head of the Bay of Fundy protects critical staging and feeding grounds for millions of migrating shorebirds. The shoreline property is the keystone in the Fundy Shorebird Project, in which NCC is a leading partner. And so, as it moves into its fifth decade of dedication to Canada's precious places, the Nature Conservancy of Canada issues a life-affirming challenge to Canada's corporations, institutions, governments, and to all Canadians who love this land. Canada's key conservation priorities exist in the settled part of our country. More than 70% of our imperiled species make their homes on the same 10% of the country where most Canadians live. Urban and industrial growth is transforming these landscapes and consuming ecosystems at an alarming rate from coast to coast to coast. It is no exaggeration to say that natural Canada as we have known it could soon be gone forever, unless we can also accelerate the pace of conservation. 40 years ago, it all started with a vision of responsible citizens acting together to protect precious places through private action. Well, Canada, the vision just got a whole lot bigger.
I think what the Nature Conservancy of Canada has accomplished over the past 40 years is nothing short of remarkable. Remarkable in terms of the land conserved and the people that came together to make that happen. And I'm just so excited about what the next 40 years holds for us and the conservation work that we are going to be achieving together.